We have been here before. 1992, Los Angeles riots over the police brutality of Rodney King. 6 days, 63 killed, 2,383 people injured, over 12,000 arrested, and property damage estimated at over $1 billion. 1996, St. Petersburg, Florida riot over the police murder of Tyrone Lewis. People took to the streets en masse. 1 day, 20 arrests, 28 arson fires, 11 injuries, and a second set of riots after the cops were cleared of all charges. 2009, the shooting of Oscar Grant. Police murder Oscar Grant III at the Fruitvale BART train station. 1 day, 105 arrests, over 300 businesses vandalized. 2013, Flatbush riots. Police murder 16-year-old Kamaya Gray. 2 days of riots and a few injuries and 46 arrests. 2014, Ferguson arrests. 2014, Oakland riots. 2015, Baltimore protests. 2016, Milwaukee riots. And that's just in my lifetime. Now it's 2020, and we have George Floyd riots. We've been here before, so where do we go next? I've asked this question to many people, and the answer I get more or less is, I don't know. I'd be lying to say I have all the answers, but what I do know is we need to keep the conversation going, and it has to be from people within the community. This is why I propose getting together the third Sunday of every month and discussing what needs to be done and what needs can be met by us working together in the community. Now, although I do believe elections matter, and ultimately that's how we will change policies, the truth is that none of the elections that follow any of those past riots that I said led to a damn thing. In fact, what I'm saying is it's only gotten worse. Only about 60% of Americans vote in the presidential election, and it's much less on off-year elections and local elections. I'll never tell you not to vote, but the problem is the system. Our policy and our politics are corrupted by money, and we all know it. Basically, if you ain't got no money, you ain't got no power, and you ain't getting nothing done. I'm not saying nothing you probably already don't know. This does, however, present a large hurdle. Like, how do you beat someone like the Walton family, owners of Walmart and Sam's Club, who have more wealth than the bottom 40% of Americans combined, or even Jeff Bezos for that matter? Well, I don't think you can. At least not at their game, because they use their wealth to corrupt our lawmakers and fix the rules for their own benefit. When you take a deeper look into how they accrued their wealth, you begin to realize that it was on the backs of those people who were working for them. Most of you, as an employee, have no real stake in the company you work for, and you're pouring your blood, sweat, and tears into a job. And your hard work, they choose to give you whatever they want for your hard work. At the end of the year, when they're trying to figure out what to do with all the profits of your labor, they do whatever they want. And 99 times out of 100, they don't end up sharing any of the profits with you. This is where we need to start.
Worker-owned cooperative.
A worker cooperative is a business that is owned and self-managed by its workers. This control may mean a company where every worker slash owner participates in decision-making in a democratic fashion, or may refer to one in which management is elected by every worker slash owner who each have one vote. This is how we can fix the problem with CEOs and board members pocketing all the money and leaving you with nothing. The Mondragon Corporation, the world's largest worker cooperative based in Spain, whose revenue was reported at $12 billion and employs over 70,000 people, by the way. The pay ratio between the lowest and highest earner was 1 in 9 in 2018. The ratio is decided by democratic vote and the worker members by comparison. The ratio between CEO pay to average earner in the top 350 U.S. companies was 1 to 321 in 2018. It doesn't have to be this way. We have the power right now to create business and work that works for everyone. Treat people right and share the profits with people who made this possible. In 50 years, we should be looking back at the concept of working for someone without any decision-making power as something that's completely insane. If you want to make money by making music, becoming a pro athlete, or carving wooden swans for all that matter, then that's fine. But if you want to make billions by employing people and not sharing the profits with your fellow man that is helping you to reach those goals, then you are part of the problem. As you can imagine, creating a worker-owned cooperative will not be easy. Corporations have the advantage of using underpaid labor and thus drive down their prices, and they have a stranglehold on all industries, basically. But it is possible. In fact, there are multiple worker co-ops that are thriving in the U.S. right now as we speak. Whether we want it to be or not, money is power, and we need to return the power to the people. Worker-owned cooperatives is just one of the answers to the question, after the 2020 George Floyd riots, where do we go next from here? And these are also some other ideas I have for you. One, we start a neighborhood watch-like organization that people can call for noise complaints or anything that you want handled that the police would be called for, excluding active shooter situations and the like. That way, you're not worried about getting someone killed over a wellness check. This group could also actively watch the police in the community as well. Two, you start a small business in your area that brings fresh local fruits and vegetables to your area. Coronavirus just showed us that having our food in one centralized location is a weakness and perfect vector for transmitting viruses, also making a small group of people rich. It would also help with people who have a hard time getting to grocery store because they live in a food desert. It doesn't have to be this way. Three, getting together at the park to know your neighbors is a perfect way to strengthen the community and prevent situations like Ahmaud Arbery, where they said they didn't know who he was and killed him while he was jogging. Four, help start a worker-owned cooperative childcare place in your area. If you have kids, you know how expensive daycare can be. Why not get together at the park and discuss ways we can do what things we can do to start a daycare in our respective areas that are more affordable and without help from a government that ain't about nothing or a corporation that's concerned about profit. These are just some examples of the things I will be discussing and trying to see what we can get going. Will it all work? Probably not. But that same thing goes for protesting and rioting, and we agree that we got to do something. If you were out in the street this week, there's no excuse. Come talk to me third Sunday of June. If you think the protests were pointless and there's another way, there's no excuse. Come talk to me the third Sunday of June. That's enough time to call out of work, plan for it, no excuses. We've been pointing out the problems. Here are some solutions. If you think they're bad ideas, come talk to me. Let me know what you think. Either way, we can do something, man. We cannot wait on the government anymore. We cannot wait on corporations. Nobody's gonna save us but us, man. And that's everybody. That's everybody. This isn't just the black people, white people, everybody. If you want to better your lives, we need to do it together, man. You can do this, y'all.
Thinking of a master plan. This ain't nothing but sweat inside my hand. So I dig into my pocket, all my money spent. So I just deep up. Still coming up for lint. So I...